Hello, parishioners. Thank you for joining us for yet another week of bonus content. We're going to talk about a wide variety of things today, but I want to start us out talking about shotness.
Huh?
Shotness.
Shot.
Shotness.
Shotness. Shotness.
Shotness. Please do not expect that I'm the expert on how to pronounce this Jewish word.
Shotness.
I'm talking about fibers. And specifically blending of fibers in your clothing. That very weird little rule that comes out of nowhere. Well, there's some theories.
Okay.
There's always theories.
Of course there are.
So shotness refers to blended fibers in clothing. There's the usual theory of the Canaanites did this, so they needed to distinguish themselves from the Canaanites. That started to become the catch-all theory of any kind of weird law modern-day people don't understand. They're like, the distinguishing laws.
So, like, the Canaanites were really into these, like, cotton with a small amount of spandex in it for, like, the stretch jeans, you know?
These kind of, like, rayon viscose blends all those things.
Right, or, like, moisture-wicking fabrics. And Yahweh's like, no.
That's really funny because actually Bobax just created a Kickstarter for these awesome travel pants that are wool on the outside, linen on the inside. Very, very not okay by Levitical law standards. Another theory was that actually the mixture of wool and linen was only used for holy garments. And so that was part of a distinguishment to make sure that it's like, this can only be used for holy purposes and not for day-to-day purposes.
Interesting.
Was that described before and I've forgotten about it from...
Nope. This is...
Oh, this is all later speculation.
Later speculation. Okay. There's also the theory that symbolically linen represents Egypt because that would have been a big product that the Egyptians would have made, and that wool, as coming from the Israelites, who are a pastoralist society, they would have been producing wool, and so blending linen and wool is this symbolic blending of Egypt and Israel, and that's no good.
No, no.
Can I ask a question?
You may.
That maybe is a naive question here.
Okay.
What's linen made of?
It is made of a plant fiber.
Like cotton is.
Yes.
But a different plant.
Yes.
Like a linen plant.
Yes.
There's
obviously
a pause there. Is that not
the linen plant?
Let me
clearly
read what I read. How did they put it? They put it as it may also be observed that linen is a product of a riverine agricultural economy.
Is it not? It's not cotton.
No, it's not cotton.
Apparently, it's the flax plant.
Yeah, right. That's what it is.
Wait,
flax.
Like flax
fibers.
Seeds?
Yeah, like flax seeds.
Really?
The fibers are turned into linen.
Wow, flax.
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. So the Egyptians loved flax seeds and also linen.
They produced a lot of linen. Yeah.
A lot of linen.
Yeah.
And then the Israelites
would have produced a lot of wool.
Okay.
All that sheep.
Because they had the sheepies.
All the
sheepies. That makes sense.
Okay.
And goaties and all kinds of stuff that would produce wool.
Okay.
So
and basically no one had cotton. That was a probably different
luxury that nobody had at this point.
Cotton's not been mentioned quite yet, but
different agricultural needs for that.
Perhaps.
Maybe.
I think the Egyptians would have had cotton. Egyptian cotton sheets.
No, that
isn't
is the thing we have now.
Yeah,
you're right.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know about back then.
Yeah.
But
I don't know
anyway,
if they
there's
were making
actual
300 thread count sheets at this point.
As long as they're not blended, however many threads you want. There's actual shotness experts to this day that will examine your clothing and will use like microscopic examination to see if there's blended fibers. I actually read about it in The Year of Living Biblically. He does that. He calls in a shotness expert to come and inspect like some of his suit coats.
Fascinating.
You know, to kind of see. And some clothing is also produced where it just has a label, shotness free, proud to be. Yeah.
Really?
Wait, so shotness
is the blending.
Means
refers
blending.
To, means
I see.
Blending.
Is blending.
Yes.
Shotness free, proud to be. Got it. Okay.
Wow.
Again, take it all with a grain of salt. That was just my preliminary research into this thing. I'm sure, you know, maybe in another space and time, we could invite a Schottnitz expert onto the show.
That would be great.
Tell us more about these things.
Specific.
Yeah.
I did. I did just now look up some stuff about cotton in ancient Egypt.
Okay.
And they did have it, but it was imported from somewhere else.
Oh, interesting.
There's debate about whether the cotton in Egypt originally came from India or from Africa.
That makes sense. Yeah.
So, yeah. Anyway, there you go.
Anyway, nice cotton. Sheets.
Nice
yeah.
sheets.
All right, well, let's talk about wizards, because everybody
you're
loves...
You're a wizard, Yahweh.
Yeah, exactly. Mean,
you're a wizard, Aaron.
Yeah, hopefully neither of them are.
Yeah.
I mean, definitely Yahweh does not like wizards.
No.
Not at all, but I like them, and it sounded like there were a lot of wizards in this particular section that we read. Something that I had forgotten, which I know we're not getting to it for a long, long time, but the gift of the Magi, those yes. are magicians.
Yes.
The Magi.
Yeah. Yes.
But what they're saying is that Magi were part of a long line of consultants to kings who worshipped various gods, practiced the occult, studied the stars, and foretold the future.
Yeah, they were kind of like astrologers and advisors. I guess that's how it was always interpreted for me. But I think that's different from wizards in this context. I think they're referring to wizards being like sorcerers or...
Well, yes. It says sorcery is condemned in the Bible, but not all magicians in the Bible are bad guys. The three wise men bowed before Jesus, and Daniel was clear that he could interpret dreams by God's power, not his.
With Joseph.
Also Joseph. And, let's not forget
Joseph.
Our boy.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I know.
Joseph.
Mr. Joseph. So, okay. But this also talks about that God warns against things when their dangers are real. So meaning like divination, worshiping other deities, psychics, tarot cards, numerology, interpreting omens, and practicing witchcraft.
I see.
And so there are some reasons for this. So apparently Lucifer, of course, just throw him into the mix.
Who has not shown up yet in the Bible we've been reading.
Oh, wait.
Right?
Mm-mm.
What about Job?
Was Lucifer? Well, no, it was, yes, Lucifer was in Job, but wasn't it that we learned that that name just meant like the prosecutor or something like that?
Well, this just says that Lucifer is known as the father of lies.
Uh-huh.
Which, right. So this says this means he usually makes things look harmless or fun for a while.
What? Okay,
no,
let me ask.
Hold on.
What?
First of all, I want her question also, but I did want to clarify, in Job, it was a Satan.
Right, that's what it was.
Satan.
Satan, yes, not Lucifer.
It was like one of the office of Satan.
Right,
but not Lucifer.
We haven't gotten to Lucifer as a name yet.
Yeah.
I was just going to ask, what Christian blog are you pulling this from?
ChristianityToday.com, of course.
So,
I mean, okay, you got to take, like, yes, an interpretation of
this.
This
is a very Christian, modern day Christian interpretation of old Levitical law.
I love what this says. It's like, Lucifer, he usually makes things look harmless or fun for a while. And fortune telling, curses, and horoscopes can seem harmless at first.
Same with Dungeons and Dragons.
But
the longer
we dabble in Lucifer's laboratory, the more likely it will affect our faith and thinking.
Definitely the name of my metal-themed music festival.
Yeah. Lucifer's Laboratory.
Lucifer's Laboratory? Yes. Yeah, that's good. Yes.
So I love this. Doing magic tricks like the disappearing coin may just be a fun way to entertain your friends, but for people who get into real sorcery, they do it to exercise power over other people, to influence them to do something they wouldn't do otherwise, or to get knowledge that isn't humanly available.
Bringing up some religious trauma for me.
Yeah, this is wow.
Well,
can we at some point on this show,
yes,
in a bonus episode, watch together Dark Dungeons?
Oh,
have either of you seen it?
Maybe a long time ago.
That it was like based on a religious tract about Dungeons and Dragons and the evils of it.
Yes,
that these people actually bought the rights.
Yes,
to
I think
that
I have, but that was a long time ago. I was in college when it came out.
Huh.
If I recall correctly.
Maybe. I don't know if it was that long ago. I've lost all sense of time though. So let me see here. The Dark Dungeons film came out in 2014. So no.
Wow.
You were not in college.
Well, I saw something in college.
I bet you did.
Anyway, it's like a, it's a, I think it's maybe 20 minutes long or something like that.
I think I have seen it.
We can watch it at some point.
Yeah. That
could be a fun thing.
Yeah, that's very much a thing in modern day evangelical Christianity of being very anti anything adjacent to the occult.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Apparently it'll lure you into the dark side.
Yeah, definitely. The story that I was told was that it's like, yeah, like playing with tarot cards is fun, and then like reading your horoscope is fun, but like that creates like a channel or creates like an opening for the devil to get in you.
Whoa.
Over time.
That's something, all right.
It is something. It is something.
Wow.
What have you got, Jason?
All right. Well, to bring some levity to the end of this bonus content here, I wanted to, we made a quick mention in the episode about every sperm is sacred.
Mm-hmm.
Emily,
Yes.
revealed after that you are not familiar with this song.
Yeah. Which,
from Monty Python.
Okay. I know I've seen it, but it's been a long time.
Okay.
What?
Oh, man. So basically, all right, let me give you a little bit of backstory
okay.
on this. So this is a little sketch that's specifically about Catholics is
okay.
the joke that they're making here. Although, as we've been reading in the Bible with the spilling of seed and stuff like that, like we see that it's in there too.
Mm-hmm.
This specific joke, though, is about, like, I guess, modern-ish at the time Catholics and their beliefs about not using birth control and things like that.
Yeah.
I just love that the very first, like the top comment on YouTube is someone saying, I remember getting suspended from Catholic school for singing this at the annual talent
show.
No.
Oh, no. I love that so much, though.
Okay, so we're going to listen to a little bit of this. I skipped past the sort of talk singy intro here.
Okay.
Emily, if you want to wheel yourself around to watch it, you can.
All right.
But otherwise, I'm just going to press play here while this father explains this to his like 50-something kids.
Every sperm is sacred. Every sperm is great. If a sperm is wasted, God gets quite irate.
Into this entire orphanage of children.
Wow.
It's not an orphanage. They're all his kids.
Oh, right. Because we're making those kind of jokes about Catholics.
Oh, yeah.
No.
Do you think they could pull this off this day and age, getting 50 children to sing this?
If anyone could do it, it would be South Park.
Okay, that's true.
Is that the mother?
Yeah, that's the mother.
In New Taoist mom, spill there's just anywhere. But God loves those who treat them.
I feel like this one older boy totally knows what's up.
Oh, goodness.
Lots of men pulling up their pants.
Every sperm is sacred.
Every sperm is good.
There's a lot of, like, lip singing here.
Yeah, of course.
It's a Monty Python sketch.
Oh God!
Wow, all right, and then okay. There's a dance number, and it goes on for a while. But
I mean, don't they realize that like multiple sperm are ejaculated when one orgasms? So
but
like
they had a fighting chance.
Okay,
I guess.
Yeah,
and that the body creates more sperm.
It is, of course, a joke.
Yes. You know, no, I know. But goodness. It is funny. And also, that woman, what, did she have like 7 kids at once every single time she got pregnant?
Well, the sketch starts with she's like doing the dishes with one of the daughters.
Yeah.
And she's just like doing them, and then like a baby falls out of her.
Oh no.
And she's like, "Oh, there's another one. Could you pick that up?"
Oh my god.
It's very Monty just Python.
That, yeah. That's horrifying.
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
Such an odd thing.
Yes.
Such an odd thing.
Yeah.
Wait, which having that many babies? Or well, just the, yes, the sacredness
just,
of sperm.
Yeah, just the phenomenon of a culture deciding, hey, this stuff, don't let it get on the ground.
Yeah.
Just don't.
Yeah. This is from The Meaning of Life. I didn't say that earlier.
Ah, okay.
Yes. Which is one of their, it's a movie, but it's really just kind of like a collection
of... A bunch of sketches
and stuff. Okay. Yeah.
Wow.
I remember watching it as a young lad and being both scandalized and also fascinated.
Yeah. Sounds about right.
Yeah, it's about on par for what that was about.
Yeah. Well, all right. Next week, I'm hoping that Yahweh doesn't give us as much to use for a drinking game.
I can guarantee there'll be more penises or sperm or something.
Well, no, I'm saying that hopefully he won't keep telling us that he is Yahweh our God.
Right. Yeah.
Because we're gonna get drunk again immediately.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll see how it goes. But yes, I'm sure more penises, more babies, more, you know, ways to kill others and et cetera, et cetera. We'll see y'all then.
Yeah. In the meantime, we have a week to recover from tonight.
Yes. Thank goodness.